Hello and welcome back to another Greater Delights Await by listening to another podcast episode of the First Time Watchers podcast.
Because we like to watch.
My name is Tim Costa.
I'm Hermano Da Silva.
And this is Walter Vinci.
And if you'd like to send feedback, you can always email us at firsttimewatchers@gmail.com. In this episode, we'll be discussing the latest Clive Barker adaptation of Hellraiser. But before we get into that, it is time for Yay or Nay. This is the part of the show where we discuss what we have seen recently on our own. I will go first. I caught up with a movie directed by Phil Tippett. This is a movie that has been in the works for about 30 years or so. Phil Tippett, known as special effects extraordinaire, getting a start with Industrial Light and Magic back at the with Star Wars, working on RoboCop, and a bunch of other movies in the 80s that you're probably very familiar with in terms of especially his stop motion animation. Mad God is a movie that was released recently, like I said, after a very long time. This movie is very gooey and wet, and a little bit more so than what I normally like, but there's no denying there's a lot of artistic effort put forth in here. The painstaking work is really something to be admired. But there's no story. There's virtually no story or central character to follow. It's really just a series of scenes that are barely stitched together. But, you know, like I said, you watch this thing and your eyes are glued because it's amazing to look at. It's just these creature designs and people designs and the practical work put into the surroundings and the settings and just every aspect of this movie is something else. So while I didn't get a lot out of this movie, other than a very cynical feeling about it, I guess in terms of how, I don't know, you look at a lot of aspects of, you know, what happens to people or characters on screen, and you just get a sense that there might be some sort of central theme of how the labor force is all part of a machine meant to spit you out once you're of no use, you know. That this is where a lot of the gooey and wetness comes from. So I don't know. I think a lot of people, this is your mileage will vary with this type of movie. You're either going to really love and appreciate it for everything put here, or you're going to come away a little mixed, probably like me. So that's a meh for Mad God. And then I caught up with the latest Peter Strickland film of Barbarian Sound Studio and Duke of Burgundy fame, and that's Flux Gourmet. Stars Gwendolyn Christie, and she's the most well-known out of everybody here, and everybody else I don't think I've ever even heard of. But the plot is set at an institute devoted to culinary and alimentary performances. A collective find themselves embroiled in power struggles, artistic vendettas, and gastrointestinal disorders. Very, very odd film. It's essentially a satire of the art community, and in that way, it is pretty biting. It uses a character who suffers from extreme flatulence as kind of commentary on the performers he is documenting. And it's kind of humorous. It's a humorous take on highbrow performance art. The sound design is very ingenious. It's, there's specifically in terms of the sound design, after performances within the context of the movie, it shows these people who, you know, who are part of the crowd watching this performance, you know, mingling about as an after show thing. And this pretentious sounding mutterings are overlaying this group of people. And it's really interesting. And the color palette is really good too. I'll tell you, Wally, you recently watched Barbarian Sound Studio, and I think you were kind of a fan of Duke of Burgundy.
Yep.
This movie is one step away from a Quentin Dupuy film.
I'm in.
And
this sounds like something I would probably dig.
And this is a movie I understand what Strickland is going for here, unlike his previous film, which was In Fabric, which was something about the fashion design or fashion community or something like that. I think that also starred Gwendolyn Christie, but I don't remember much of it. I just remember not liking it as much as this movie. So while it's not nearly as over the top or on the nose in terms of its I wouldn't say parody, but at least comedy, as a Quentin Dupuis film, it gets pretty close to that. So I think you would find a lot to like out of Flux Gourmet. So that's a mild A for that. Hermano.
All right. First thing I watched was a film from this year called Beast.
Oh.
A father and his two teenage daughters find themselves hunted by a massive rogue lion intent on proving that the savannah has but one apex predator. Who the hell wrote that? What the synopsis should say is, hey, does anybody want to watch a movie that's part Cujo, part Jaws?
Yes.
And features a lion instead of a shark? And I got the movie for you. It's called
Nice.
Beast.
Nice.
Tim, you didn't see this? I thought you'd seen this.
No, I have not seen this.
Oh, it's on Peacock right now. Decided to check it out, and it's okay. You know, it stars Idris Elba and Charlton Copley, which I haven't seen in a while in anything, and it was really good to see him again.
Well, Charlton Copley is today's greatest living actor, so that's good.
He's consistently good, even in that Spike Lee movie, which I will not name. But yeah, he's in this. He's kind of, you know, he's not doing his Charlton Copley thing per se, but he's just, it's kind of like a role that's, I wouldn't say it's beneath him, but it's just kind of a, like a paycheck role, you know, he's not like putting in a performance per se. So, but it's, you know, it's an okay film. Like I said, it's a little bit Cujo. These, Idris Elba and his daughters are there to visit the homeland where their mother grew up. Their mother since passed away. And, they meet up with Charlton Copley, who had introduced, Idris Elba to, the mother. And they're going to go on like a little safari, and you know, things happen, and they get trapped in the car, hence the Cujo element. And then the lion, just not acting like a typical lion would normally, especially a male lion would normally act. So hence the Jaws part where, you know, animals are like just acting a fool. And, it's decent, you know, as a thriller, you know, it's just kind of survival instinct type stuff. It just always a doctor. He has, you know, skills for that, but not necessarily survival skills. So he's got to try to do the best he can with, you know, what he's got. And yeah, it's like I said, it's a decent thriller. If you like Cujo, if you like Jaws, you know, it's not nearly as good as either of those films. But if you're looking for like a, you know, a decent little thriller, you know, you could do worse. So Beast is kind of like a mild yay. I saw something that Tim's gonna squeal about.
Ooh.
And I blame COVID on this.
Oh.
I watched Moonfall.
That's next on my list, actually. I saw that it was available on, I think, HBO Max.
Now, I didn't know a lot about the film going in. I don't even remember if I saw a trailer, to be honest.
Oh, boy.
If I did, I'd completely erased it from my memory.
Oh, this movie goes in directions.
A mysterious force knocks the moon from its orbit and sends it hurtling on a collision course towards Earth. It's exactly what happens. And I could not envision where this film would go. I mean, it's got some pretty big ideas. I don't know, it's going pretty heavy sci-fi. And you know, again, I'll blame COVID, but it was entertaining.
Sure.
For the most part.
Yeah.
You know, it's silly, obviously, and not meant to be taken seriously, but it had some pretty decent effects, I gotta say, like, especially towards the end when, you know, hence the moon falling, and you see, like, what would that do to the Earth?
Yeah, very realistic.
I mean, I think some of it, like, the oceans receding, things like that.
Right.
Tsunamis, like, I think, yes, that would probably, you know, happen, maybe. But a lot of the other stuff with, like, the way the orbit, I guess, works, and the way it starts acting like a vacuum, basically.
This movie's so fucking stupid.
It is. But, you know, like I said, it's entertaining, not meant to be taken seriously. I'm not going to give it a yay. It's kind of a meh, but it's fun. It's, you know, if you have COVID like I did, and you have, like, all this free time, it's perfect. It's a perfect film to just fill up that time. So, that's a meh for Moonfall. And lastly, I saw something, finally used that Criterion Channel subscription again, and I watched the film from 1953 called Inferno.
Oh.
A tough, hard-driving business tycoon suffers a broken leg and is left to die in the desert by his scheming wife and her greedy lover. The reason I watched this is because it's an hour and a half long, and I like the synopsis. This film wastes absolutely no time. Like, literally the first scene and I've never seen this before in a film that I can remember, is the leaving the husband to die has already happened. You haven't even met the husband yet, and the lover and the wife are already covering their tracks. So they're establishing, they're planting evidence basically to make it look like maybe he got drunk and wandered off into the desert and died. And they're like, you know, planting footprints and, you know, trying to establish alibis, like what they're going to say and things like that. And I'm like, this is how the movie's starting? Like, we haven't even met the husband yet. Like, you haven't even met any characters really yet. You're meeting them for the first time right now, and they're already doing this thing. And so it's unique in that way. And then it cuts to the husband, and you see where they left him, claiming that they were going to go for help. And his entire dialogue, because he's by himself, is internal. So you're hearing as if you can hear him talking to himself, but he's not actually talking.
Oh, cool.
So it's him just kind of like sussing things out. Like, man, it's weird too, because this isn't a big spoiler, but he immediately, because they've been gone for so long, starts assuming that they maybe left him.
Mm.
And he starts getting the idea in his head, like, I'm going to have to get out of here by myself. And that's what gets him, like, with his broken leg and all, trying to figure out how he's going to walk out of this desert alive with barely any water and barely any food and with a broken leg. So it's just him, like, just working things out, talking to himself. How am I going to get down off this cliff? How am I going to, like, wrap this leg? You know, it's just it's really unique film. I can see why it's on Criterion. It's basically a survival thing. It's kind of like The Edge in a way, where it's just one man against the elements and trying to traverse, you know, the desert, the heat, you know, lack of water, things like that. And, you know, it does, you know, cut back and forth a little bit with what the lover and the wife are doing to kind of try to sell their story back in civilization to, like, their friends and, like, you know, things like that. And it goes places. You know, I'd say 90% of the movie with the guy, the main actor, it, like I said, is just, you're just hearing his thoughts about, like, how he's going to overcome certain things. And it's really unique. And, like, of course, the last, you know, bit of the film, it becomes a little bit more of a thriller, but it's pretty solid film overall. And I think its claim to fame too is it's, I guess it had some pretty ahead of its time 3D.
This poster is amazing.
Yeah. It's a pretty solid film overall. Like, I was not upset that, you know, I took the time to watch this. I thought it was pretty clever and just kind of unique in a lot of different ways. And I can definitely see why, you know, Criterion, you know, put this on their curation. So, yeah, big yay for Inferno.
Cool. Wally.
All right, so I saw a couple of movies. I saw a movie from 1983 that it's interesting, to say the least, because this movie skates the... It really completely walks the line between artsy fartsy bullshit nonsense and horror movie. 1983 is The Hunger.
Oh, yeah.
Love triangle develops between a beautiful yet dangerous vampire played by Catherine Deneuve, her cellist companion David Bowie, and a gerontologist played by Susan Sarandon, directed by Tony Scott. I will also point out there are no cars that flip over in this, nothing really flips over. But this movie is like one part like new wave art film, one part vampire story.
I remember this movie reminding me of Only Lovers Left Alive.
It is very much in that same vein, but way they really turn the artsy stuff like this, because like at heart it is a vampire story and like, you know, the person dealing with, you know, vampirism and all that stuff. But that there are like a lot of like artistic choices in here that are just like.
Yeah,
Tony Scott, I think, just flexing his creative muscles and how he like shoots some things.
Yes, yes.
But yeah, this is a yay. I would say this is a yay because Kate had asked, like, she's like, "Is this artsy fartsy bullshit nonsense?" And I was like, "It almost does it, and then pulls itself back at the last second."
Not enough, David Bowie.
David Bowie's great in this. I mean, for the short amount of screen time that he is on it, he's good.
Yeah.
You know, I think everybody does a fine job in this. I was kind of hoping for more Willem Dafoe. But you know, can't have everything we want. But yeah, I would say the Hunger is a yay. And then as a comparison, probably bringing this up over the course of the podcast, is I actually watched the original Hellraiser, which is a first time watch for me. I've never actually seen the original. A woman discovers the newly resurrected, partially deformed body of her brother-in-law. She starts killing for him to revitalize his body so he can escape the demonic beings that are pursuing him after he escaped the sadistic underworld. Directed by Clive Barker, the guy who wrote the story. This is also another yay. This is another. I'll bring this up when we talk about the current version. That a lot of these help, like the this version of the Hellraiser movie. It's hard for me to classify it completely. Like, I don't think it's completely a horror movie. Kind of more like a supernatural murder mystery. Based on everything that goes on in it. But this is also very much this movie has got some. This is a insane part where you see like the zombie guy forming like in the house, and it's all done in that they made a dummy and did all these things to it, and then shot it, and then played it back in reverse. It's pretty good. I would say this is also a yay.
From what I can tell, no one has seen Walter in a long time.
But wait, you hear that?
I don't hear anything.
Exactly. Peace and quiet.
Hey, what's that over there?
It looks like some sort of Rubik's Cube. Wait a second.
But you know what show is always worth the wait?
The In Session Film Podcast.
That's right, Tim. The In Session Film Podcast is JD and Brendan.
Brendan.
Anyways, each week the In Session Film Podcast chooses a movie to review.
Then creates a top three list based on what they just saw.
This week, the In Session Film Podcast is reviewing David O. Russell's latest, Amsterdam.
And continue their Studio Ghibli movie series with Howl's Moving Castle.
You can find their show on Apple Podcasts by searching for, you guessed it, the In Session Film Podcast.
Or on the web at insessionfilm.com.
So if you're looking for more great movie reviews and discussion,
then check out the In Session Film Podcast on Apple Podcasts.
Or on the web at insessionfilm.com.
Hermano, will you stop fiddling with that thing, please?
Oh, shit.
Oh, no, you don't.
What the hell was that?
Where'd that cube go?
Alright guys, so we need to record our top three reasons why you should listen to French Toast Sunday podcast.
Number three should definitely be our diverse opinions.
Number two should probably be our top three lists that we do every week.
No, it's gotta be Mark Wahlberg.
What about Gwyneth Paltrow's head?
It's gotta be fighting the sadness in the swamp of sadness.
Full frontal.
Stories about being lost at sea.
Brendan Fraser being underground.
Helen Mirren's boobs.
Baltimore accents as heard in The Wire.
Underclothes. Crepes.
Character studies.
Wait, guys. What about movies?
No.
Tree rape.
Hmm.
Tree rape? Yeah, I like tree rape.
Tune in every Friday for a new episode of French Toast Sunday podcast brought to you by us at FrenchToastSunday.com.
This podcast is a proud member of the Lamb Podcasting Network. Find the network at largeassmovieblogs.com.
Okay, let's talk about Hellraiser.
Hey. Hi, come here. I just found so much weird shit about this boy guy. All sorts of fucked up sex stuff, accusations. There was money laundering, too. And then 6 years ago, he just disappears. Nobody knows what was wrong.
The lawyer's gone, too.
What? What do you mean? What are you talking
Lineker.
About?
I called because I was worried about her hand, and they said that she wasn't there. She was in the infirmary, and then she wasn't, and no one saw her leave, so...
Fuck.
Yeah, fuck. We need to get rid of that thing, Riley, all right? What are you doing?
First my brother, then Serena Menaker, the same exact shit 6 years ago. Look,
In the weeks leading up to Voice's appearance, there were others too. There was a groundskeeper, there was a sex worker, and there were probably ones that nobody even knew about. And they're all loosely connected to him and his estate, and they're all fucking gone. They're all gone. It's happening again. I know that this guy has something to do with it, and I know that that thing does too. It opens up, and it cuts you. And then when it does, you... We have to go there. To his estate, it's not that far.
The plot. A young woman struggling with addiction comes into possession of an ancient puzzle box, unaware that its purpose is to summon the Cenobites. Cenobites? Cenobites? Cenobites. How do you say that? The director, David Bruckner. The actors, Odessa Aizion, Jamie Clayton, Adam Faison, and some other fodder. Walter. Walter, you just talked about your first time viewing of the original Hellraiser. How did this viewing of the new Hellraiser go?
So, I'm going to clarify this. This is not a remake. It's not a remake.
I don't think anybody's saying it's a remake. I think people are just saying...
No, I'm just clarifying for the audience.
I see.
It's not a remake. This is I would say it's a pretty solid-ass reimagining of the original Hellraiser movie. I found the first Hellraiser movie to be wildly entertaining. I think that the imagery in this, especially at the end when we get to that in spoilers, probably the end scene of this movie is probably one of the scariest things I've ever seen in a horror movie that actually made me go, "That's terrifying."
Hmm.
I think that I like the way that this movie also takes the approach of less is more, in terms of what you see on screen. I think the only major criticism I can give this movie off out of the gate is that it looked really dark on my TV, so like a lot of scenes just were kind of muddy and hard to see. But overall, I think that this is a solid horror movie, if you can call it a horror movie, because again, this is kind of like a advanced level Scooby-Doo. You're dealing with the disappearance of the main character's brother, and they're trying to figure out where he went. And as they're going along, they're finding all these other crazy, scary things that are along the way. So I'm looking at it, it's kind of its own thing when you look at it, because it can go in either direction. But yeah, I had a good time with this one too. I think this one was really well done. I have a question though. I'm surprised that, because whenever there's a female in a role that was previously played by a male, there tends to be a lot of Twitter outrage about it. And I didn't see any of that going into this, online or anything like that. So I'm curious if you guys saw anything like that throughout your feeds by any chance.
What kind of outrage again?
You know, it's that whole why is Pinhead a woman?
Like
all that bullshit. You know what I mean?
No, I don't think I saw any kind of discourse around that. Who knows? Either way, because I don't think it really matters, who plays.
No, Pinhead? I don't think so either. Because I think you're dealing with extra dimensional monsters.
Right.
Can be anything.
Also could be that Jamie Clayton is a trans actor and actress, and she, I don't know.
I'll be touching on that point later.
Okay, fair enough. Playing on certain elements in terms of what the underlying themes are of this story, the original story and either the original adaptation or this one. So who knows? Hermano, what is your relation to the original Hellraiser, and what did you think of this film?
I ended up rewatching the original as well because it had been a really long time. I remember as a kid being really bored by it compared to the other big three horror icons of the decade, being Michael Myers, Jason, and Freddy. And I think I'd only seen it maybe once, maybe two times tops before, and it had been so long, like more than 25 years. So I, I wanted to reacquaint myself with it, and then compare, like Wally said, he was going to do to the new one, and that boredom carried over into adulthood. It just all came flooding back to me as to why I never really appreciated the original Hellraiser. I remember as a kid feeling like the horror elements, like Wally was saying, like were kind of backseated to what was otherwise like a kind of a gory drama. So yeah, I just remember it not being my thing. So, and I also think that Pinhead was kind of silly. You know, again, that was as a kid. I still think he's kind of silly, but I get it, I guess, on some level, like why people find him, or her, I guess, in this case now, like intriguing on some level. There's like a mystery to the characters. It's not, you don't ever really know a lot about them. But as far as the new one goes, I would say that I went kind of back and forth on which one I thought was dumber, the original or the new one, because I couldn't get into it, man. I there were points where the new one where I'm like, all right, I think they're doing this better than the original. And then it would go and do something that I thought was like, all right, I think the original did this better. And I just, in a way, I kind of wished I had not seen the original, because I did find myself comparing them a lot. But that's not to say that the new one, I just didn't like any of the characters. I thought it was really dumb. At least in the original, there's like a reason why there are like two characters that are kind of driving the film and getting, you know, their evil plan, you know, across. And it makes sense as to like why the box is there and why people are doing what they're doing. But in the new one, it's so dumb as to why they continually hold on to this fucking box and are just like, I don't know, someone got cut and all of a sudden they died. I think we should hold on to this box. It's like, I don't know, man. It just doesn't make any sense. I just couldn't get behind the film with it's the characters being just, the whole film boils down to curiosity kill the cat. It's like every character is just too curious and too stupid for their own good. And that's the only way that we can get from scene to scene. Mm. There's nothing really smart going on. It's like the characters are required to be dumb and be continuously work against their own interests so that we can get the movie from scene to scene. And I just could not get behind it on any level. I also, like I said, I didn't like any of the characters. I thought the characters were really unlikable. It was hard to get behind even the lead actress because, yes, she's dealing with like addiction and that sucks, but it's like she's got all these people around her and she continuously, again, fights against her own best interests and gets people killed, you know, and then by the end, it's like, I don't know, we'll get there, but like there's this like decision that she makes and I'm just like, I don't know, man, this doesn't redeem you necessarily. It's not like an admission of guilt or anything necessarily, but it's just kind of like I don't know, it just did nothing for me. So overall, I was not a huge fan of the Hellraiser. The new one just didn't improve that much over the original.
Well, yeah, I understand where you're coming from, however I didn't, you know, hate this movie as much as you did. I kind of enjoyed it to a degree. I'm gonna fall right again, I guess, for the second week in a row in the middle of you two. And what you talk about in terms of their decisions, you know, the structure and aesthetic of this movie follows in the footsteps of 80s and 90s horror films. And I think to its detriment, because, you know, there's these very loose logic holding together this plot, which I guess is right in line with those decisions that you're talking about, that where they only serve the purpose of moving from one set piece to the next. There's little care put into any of the character arcs. Like, there's these predictable beats, and it lowers these emotional stakes for me, you know? I think there are some really cool visuals here, whether they're the structural movements of the buildings and the vehicles or these gross, icky, flesh-splitting creature designs. You know, I guess that's ultimately the reason you go into a film like this, and Bruckner delivers. You know, it's nice that it seems like there was a lot done here practically and not overly reliant on CGI, especially with the, you know, the creature designs, the gore designs, the anything involving bodily modifications. there's a lot of practical work there, and I kind of dug it. I just wish this overall metaphor of the pain of overcoming substance abuse was a little more, you know, overt throughout, instead of being, it's very bluntly stated at the end of the movie. And it's not really there throughout. You know, there isn't enough time spent with this main character of Riley and her struggle with addiction, and any connection of that to the physical pain in order to make that attachment, you know, that mental leap of these chains that we see on screen to her mental anguish. You know, it's tough, you know. Now I am someone who has not seen the original Hellraiser. I think I've only seen a few scenes on cable like 10 or 15 years ago. And so I don't have anything to compare it to. The only thing I know is that, you know, it's involving a woman who's like cheating on her husband or something like that. And in the original story, in the original film.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep.
And it's, you know, I guess it's, you know, themes of sexual desire and pain and the S&M undertones are a lot more easy to understand, you know, and get in that movie than whatever it is in terms of the substance abuse here and addiction. So I don't know. It's fine. You know, it delivers on certain things and then doesn't go hard enough into, you know, it's something if you want to go for a more modern take and, you know, quote unquote elevated horror in terms of, drawing in a more modern, theme, then it doesn't really deliver there. Wally, anything else you want to add here?
This, you guys hit on the points I was about to make next. This movie is borderline tokenism when it comes to the characters. It's these elements that could maybe have been explored more and are just not, just for the sake of having it in the movie. Like you have you have the addict, which they don't really, outside of like that opening scene where she sees Pinhead, isn't really, they don't really do anything with that afterwards. You know,
you have a gay couple and they don't explore anything
nothing
there
either. You know what I mean?
Right. And
that whole relationship that there's like nothing, they don't really like flesh it out enough to make it. So like, all right, so I guess that's the guy's boyfriend. I guess that's why he cares. You know what I mean?
Right.
But there's no meat on that bone either.
Yeah. Why is he so invested in seeing his boyfriend's sister, you know, be well? You're right.
Yeah, and then you've got I guess she's a trans actress playing this demon that's, you know, neither male nor female. And again, they don't go into any of that either.
Right, right.
So it's all like, it's, and tokenism is too hard, maybe too harsh a word, because they at least, I guess included it, but like they don't do anything with it. It's there for their sake.
Mm.
And that's annoying, but I mean, I still had a good time with this movie. But I mean, Herman also makes a valid point too, is there's that scene where, I don't know if this is a spoiler or not, but where the main character is talking to Pinhead and like holding the box.
Yep.
And they're like, oh, we want blood. She's like, no. I'm like, at that point, you just put the box down. because you don't know what you're dealing with.
Yeah, well, no,
in the proximity of this demon that apparently shows up when I'm near this thing.
I
don't want to be holding the bag.
I don't know. I think by this point, there's a basic understanding that there's something that has to be completed in order to get her brother back. So
yeah, I get that the only way out is through thing. But like, I feel like it could have, like, you know, like Hermano's point is that you could have kind of maybe sort of stopped there if you just put the thing on the floor. But no, not touching it.
Hermano, what did you think about the production design, the creatures, and anything like that?
Again, to compare the two films, the original had a lot of, like Wally was saying, had some pretty decent, like, I wouldn't say quite on the level of like something like The Thing, but there was some pretty decent like 80s level practicals in the original. And the one scene that probably stands out is the one Wally already mentioned, where like the guy's like nervous system or whatever is just like slowly regenerating. And it looked pretty decent for like a stop motion, you know, practical, you know. And there was some other like creature stuff, you know, obviously the practicals with the Cenobites or whatever. In this one, again, I think they tried to stick with the kind of the overall feel of the original. Like, there are some, you know, decent practicals with the makeup, obviously. But I think, I mean, I'm assuming the box was like all CGI and stuff, where in the, and it moves on its own. In the original, you know, someone had to actually physically move it.
I don't know. The box.
I think the prop they're holding is legit. And I think that just like the CGI thing was moving by itself. You know, obviously CGI.
I don't know.
It's all practical.
I wouldn't be surprised if there's a good amount of practical effects with that box.
I don't know. Again, like a lot of my, I think I'm weighing this film too against like a lot of the other like good horror films I've watched recently, where, you know, they're just a little bit smart, you know, like the quote unquote, like smart horror or whatever people want to call it.
Elevated,
you know,
like I was saying.
Yeah. It's just like when you see something like this, it just feels like it's a film that's taking a couple steps back, like a lot of steps back for me, because it just feels like the characters are really dumb. They need to be dumb. The whole thing you're trying to make, Tim, I'm not even sure the film was really trying to make some sort of like connection or allegory with her substance abuse and what else is going on in the film.
Well, I think by the end, it's very clear.
Yeah, I'm not sure. I mean, at least that didn't really come across for me. I just thought like, you know, again, not having seen the original, a lot of that like same stuff happens in the original with like the chains and all that stuff. And in the original, it is more of like some sort of like a character that has like gotten bored with like traditional, like all the different feelings of pleasure and things like that he's experienced. And he's looking for something beyond that. And then that's what gets him to track down the Cenobites, and he gets a little bit more than he bargained for, basically. Again, in this one, it's a very similar character with that character that you know, opens up the film.
Oh well,
he's very similar to the guy in the original, like, well, his intentions, basically.
Yeah, that's very. Man, I wish there was a little bit more to that too, because by the time we revisit him at the end of the movie, I'm like, man, it's so loose in terms of how this guy was involved and how he got to this point that we see him at the end of the movie. That man, it's just. It's not really that well handled.
It's par for the course, honestly. Like the original, you really don't know anything about the box, really. You don't know anything about the Cenobites. You get like absolute bare bones explanation as to what they might be or how some people view them, you know, things like that. It's just all a big mystery.
Okay.
And it's kind of what it is in this one, too. Like the guy just is similar. Like he's similar to the guy in the original where he's like, oh, I've experienced everything else there is to experience. Let me track down this box and see what these... You know, if these people can offer me something different,
okay,
then, it's always like this.
Then if they're not going to give you any explanation, you need to make that metaphor a lot more clear. You know, whether it's sexual desire in the original movie or addiction in this movie, you need to make that struggle a lot more clear and say, here is what is so appealing about the addiction, the lure of drugs, or whatever substance you're using, and make that leap just more obvious.
I think it would have made more sense if, like, the main character, what the driving force for her was the mystery of the box itself.
Right.
But she doesn't seem that interested necessarily in, like, why the box exists or like, you know, what's happened. She's kind of just like, feels like she's just carrying it and asking people like, do you know anything about this? It doesn't seem like it's a big driving force for her,
yeah,
other than when her brother disappears. And then it kind of becomes a little bit more for her. But even then it's like, look, man, like you don't even, I think this is a spoiler, so I'll talk about this in spoilers, but like, there's a point where it becomes a bigger deal for her, but it's so late in the movie that it's like, this should have been something like that should have been explained to her way earlier, so that could have been a driving force for the entire film. But otherwise, she's just stupidly carrying the box around that seems to clearly align with the fact that people are dying that have touched this box.
Yeah.
And it's like, why do I keep carrying this thing? I would have put this thing down like hours ago.
Yeah, there's this you know, millionaire or whatever who opens up the movie with this. He has this woman lackey, you know, henchman or whatever, and she appears later, midway through the movie, I should say, and I'm thinking to myself, wait a minute, is this the same woman? It took me a minute to realize that it was the same person. And then I was thinking to myself, well, wait a minute, how did she end up here? And then, wait a minute, how did this girl and her boyfriend end up here in this hospital where she is staying? And they wave it away with some, we found the deed or something, you know, something on a, while they were researching where they found the box in that location. And I'm thinking to myself, wait a minute, you're not even going to give us a little bit of their investigation that leads us to this moment, because it's this 80s and 90s horror film logic again that is to this film's detriment of getting from one place to the other. It was just kind of confusing. And even then, you know, the struggle that they have in order for this lady who's dying in the first place of some lung condition or whatever, is, you know, she gets stabbed by the box, and I'm like, okay. And her running around these hallways, I'm like, oh, all right. And they don't really pay it off with showing anything with her, you know, with them capturing her or doing anything much to her. But still, you get to see these really cool creature designs, and I really appreciated the some of the aesthetics of this movie. I don't know. Wally, is there anything else to mention before we get into spoilers?
I mean, what you said about, like, how the, you know, they get from point A to point B, like... maybe this is a spoiler. I'll wait till spoilers.
All right, let's get into spoilers.
All right, so, like, we were talking about, like, going from point A to point B, like something they never bothered to really get into is, like, how, like, the main character's boyfriend, like, knows the villain.
Right.
But, like, you know, it makes sense that he's taken him to all these other places, like, how they know he would know to go there because he's part of this, you know, bad guy's plan. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But, like, without that explanation or any sort of, like, foreshadowing, it's again, it's that weird kind of like Scooby-Doo kind of thing, like, oh, who, we'll see who you really are, you know. And again, like, also too, like, you know, I mentioned to kids, like, if I ever found this thing, I'd be playing with salad tongs, like, one on each side, like, messing with pieces, because, like, clearly this thing is dangerous, especially after you see, like, the first time it tries to freaking nip you, like, maybe wear some sort of cut-proof glove. Maybe manipulate it with something else that's not your hands. You know, I think that would be a smart idea. But the end of the scene where you see the villain being turned into a Cenobite, I found that absolutely terrifying.
Interesting.
Just the idea of you were alive, and now you're in this, like, limbo realm. And you, like, look, like, the way he looks, like, the way they did, like, the skin effects on him, where, like, his skin's all mottled and it's, like, losing all of its, like, identity there. And just, like, on that machine that's making him, like, it's, like, turning him into this thing. And it's, like, it just reminds me of, like a complete nightmare that I would probably have. I found that to be, like, the scariest part of this movie. I was, like, I can't begin to describe how terrifying I find it. But that's, like, literally, like, I was like, holy shit, that was terrifying.
I was just, you know, a little befuddled as to how Goran Vesnich's character even got to this point, you know, in the walls of his own mansion, and what is this, you know, we see in this book that they find, you know, these five or six steps, you know, these levels of whatever this box is, or whatever the choices are, I don't even really know. And I'm like, well, what happened to him? You know, how did he get to this point where he's in these walls and he has this device in the middle of his chest? And what is this device doing? And what's the purpose of it? I didn't.
Well, he does say what it is. It's exactly so. It's what happened. So, you know, at the beginning, you see that dude get killed.
Yes.
And he wants to make a deal with Leviathan.
Right.
They show up. That was the fifth victim.
Yeah.
And then they give him the choices of,
whatever those six choices are. Yeah, like, yeah.
Life.
Yeah, and he picked Leviathan, right?
You know, he picks liminal. He picks pleasure.
Okay.
Well, sensation. And he chooses sensation. That's when that mandolin thing comes spinning out of the sky, which if I saw that, like, this was a terrible idea, wouldn't it? And then gets put into his body, and what it does is, like, it attached it to his nerves and made his nerves like strings.
Okay.
And so it will twist and tighten those nerve endings to hurt him. So he's always going to have a sensation. It's not a positive one. It's not what he had hoped for.
There was clearly something within the storytelling device that didn't make it land for me. And
it didn't, because like in the it's in the similar vein as the the original too, is that he's supposed to be like this like hedonist. He's supposed to be like this guy who gets off on the excesses.
Right, and that makes...
eats, drinks, fucks.
That makes sense.
And they never really show you any of that outside of that one scene where he's in his, like, that mansion, and you see, like, the orgy going on in the other room.
Right, exactly. So that makes sense in the context of that first film that you're talking about, you know, and it doesn't, you know, because we don't have any knowledge of this character.
That's the thing. That orgy scene is in this movie, is in this reimagining.
Yeah.
It's in the first opening. It's in the opening scene.
Right. But it's not very well connected to this guy. You know, it's just,
yeah, it's not.
Yeah.
Because like, he's like, you see that the dude like walking through, and like, when I went back and like looked up on like the wiki on it, he's supposed to be like a sex worker.
Okay.
So they never show you that either. It just looks like some dude at somebody's house.
Sure.
You know what I mean? There's like no connection, like you said, that connection isn't there. He walks by an orgy room, meets the woman assistant,
yep,
who then takes him so that he can be that last sacrifice, so the villain can get his sensation gift from the Cenobites, which obviously it's not what it is. But again, too, if you're seeing these things, what would make you think that anything good's gonna come of this?
Like, I
played with the box. Sorry, like, something happens, and then like this person with pins in their face, this person who is like got like a throat slit and pulled open. This other guy who's got no face at all, just teeth, and like chains pull out, and they hook people and they rip them apart. And like, you didn't think anything. You thought something good was gonna come of this? Like nothing of this ran any sort of, I don't know, sort of red flag. And then, you know, the plan to get this thing removed from him. I'm like, do you think this is really going to go the way you think it's going to go?
Yeah, you're going to make some sort of deal with this demon character? Exactly.
Yeah.
Hermano, anything about the ending here?
Yes. So, correct me if I'm wrong, but the lead character of Riley, her, I guess, boyfriend or a guy she's hooking up with or whatever, Trevor?
Yeah.
Yep.
So that character is working with the main villain. Bad guy or whatever, right. The villain.
Yeah.
Roland.
That's the twist. You know, you discover that. But... correct me if I'm wrong, but throughout the entirety of the rest of the film, isn't he basically telling her, get rid of that thing, get rid of the box, you know, fuck that thing, leave it behind? So how the hell is he still...
Well, I think...
If she had listened to him and said, yeah, you're right, fuck this box. Like, else is he going to, like...
Baby, let's not be hasty.
Yeah, no, he would probably go back and get it wherever she left it.
Yeah, but I mean, that makes it all the more obvious that, you know, something's up with him. Like, it'd be so suspicious if the guy's like, just told me, get rid of the box, and all of a sudden he shows up back with the box. So
the thing is, like, I think that what's missing here is another piece of connective tissue, where the idea is Trevor's supposed to care about her, and his mission is not to bring her necessarily, but to bring five victims to the box. Could be any five victims.
Yeah, I don't know.
I think when she first finds it, she's fiddling, and he's like, well, yeah, you probably should, like, you should, I don't want to touch it, like, whatever, because he knows what it is. And then, you know, after, like, the first person is taken away, he's like, oh, why, put it down, like, don't touch it, leave it alone. Because I think what his plan was going to be was to find another victim he doesn't know.
Yeah, I suppose that makes sense. But again, the film doesn't make sense the way it's depicting everything happening.
Like, yeah, I think if they had more connective tissue and they explored that whole like drug abuse thing, I think you could make, and they actually went along with it, where like he brings a friend back to his like a rack shack that he's like living in. You know, he gets him high and then gives him the puzzle and is like, here, check this out. And then the guy, whoever, like the victim, starts fucking with it. You know what I mean?
Yeah, but the thing is, too, that would make more sense. if he didn't want her involved in any way, like, why even bring her to the break-in? Like, he could have done everything that he did by himself. Right. Like, fair he didn't point. Need her at all. Like, it's just, I don't know. I think the film
you make a good point there, because, like, she would have been the first victim if she had gotten pinched.
Yeah, like, she's literally the first one that fucks with the box. Like, you know, like, she easily could have been the first victim. But no, like, I don't know. It's weird. The film's just, again, with its characters, it does no service to the characters. Everyone has to be dumb. And justice for the brother in the Nora character. Right. Like, those two characters just absolutely got fucked in this movie.
No way to be seen.
In the world of this movie. What's that?
No justice to be seen anywhere. They get no comeuppance. Even with What's-Her-Face selecting, you know, him as, like, you know, as a victim.
Yeah.
Okay. Like, yeah. This all could have been avoided, like you said.
I think the only interesting thing the film did that I haven't seen a lot of the other Hellraisers, so I don't know if this has already been explored, but the idea at one point that she actually stabs one of the Cenobites with it,
yeah,
and that's an actual option.
That's the first time I've ever seen.
Yeah, I was like, all right,
you could have just done this.
I think that was the one and only time the film actually surprised me, because I didn't even assume that would be an option, and to find out that it was that way, it was just like, oh, that's interesting. I you know, it's one of the only unique ideas I think the film really had for me. Like, you know.
So I reached out to Twitter asking for reactions to this movie, and I got a couple of replies.
So we have to say, people.
Burke Braxy at Czar Jordan, Doug the Vision, thought the atmosphere was great, but it didn't resonate with me like the OG. And Andrew at AM Garvey, I've watched every Hellraiser film. I've read every book and every comic adaptation. Clive Barker retweeted my custom Hellraiser Lego. The original is my favorite horror film. This is the best Hellraiser film since the 80s. Jamie Clayton was awesome. 8 out of 10. Well, Andrew, wow. With that, let's get into grades. Wally.
I think this is a service of... I think the... You know, the original Hellraiser is like kind of like a B movie, and I think that the issues that we've talked about here take it down a peg, so it's probably like a C+.
I am exactly with you. It is a C+ movie for me as well. I think it's an interesting entry into the franchise, especially if you're like me, have never seen any of the films before. So I'm going with the C+. Hermano.
It's a C- for me. I'd say the original is maybe a C at best.
Interesting. Okay, that does it for this episode of the First Time Watchers podcast. Donate via patreon.com/firsttimewatchers or buy stuff at zazzle.com/firsttimewatchers.
And you can follow us on Twitter at 1STTimeWatchers on Twitter.
Or write to us at our email, firsttimewatchers@gmail.com.
Please download our episodes on Apple Podcasts and Stitcher. Feel free to leave a review. Any feedback is greatly appreciated. If you have any suggestions of movies for us to watch, please send a tweet or an email. Speaking of suggestions, let's recommend a movie. I'm going to go first. So David Bruckner directed this movie. David Bruckner also directed a movie from 2020, which was released in like the height of the pandemic and got the real shaft, unfortunately. But it is called The Night House and stars one of our finest living actors today, Rebecca Hall. And this movie is a widow begins to uncover her recently deceased husband's disturbing secrets. And, this is a solid, solid flick. Rebecca Hall does a great job here. She does a lot of heavy lifting as primarily the lone person on screen. And what she does is react to strange bumps in the night and wonders if she's going crazy or not. I'm not sure the ending is as well executed as intended, but it's still very entertaining and very atmospheric, and it keeps you guessing. If you saw some of these interesting visuals in this Hellraiser movie, this movie, The Night House, has some really unique and amazing visuals in terms of the architecture of the house that she lives in and utilizing that within her what she may or may not be seeing. So I would recommend seeking out The Night House. Wally.
I'm going to recommend a movie I had watched prior. I recommend the original Hellraiser. I think that it's a fun movie. You know, it's got some gore to it. It's got some scary bits to it. And part of a trilogy. And I'm looking forward to seeing the other two, so I'm going to recommend the first Hellraiser.
Hermano, are you going to make it easy here?
No.
Oh, interesting.
I'm going to recommend an animated, I guess I'll call it a film, though. It was actually a series, but it only lasted 10 episodes. It's from 2014. It's called Over the Garden Wall.
Oh, yeah.
Watch this with the kids for family movie night. Like I said, even though it's technically a cartoon series, each episode is, I want to say somewhere between like 10 and, actually, I want to say that about 10 minutes long. So then, you know, the entire thing took us about, you know, an hour and whatever, 40 minutes or whatever, to watch. So we kind of watched it like a movie, basically, because it's one big story. And I dug it. It's from the people behind Adventure Time. Animation style is very similar. It's kind of a cute story about these two brothers who find themselves lost in the woods. It's kind of got like a New England / kind of a folklore, old-timey feel to it. And it's just kind of cute with them trying to find their way back home. There's something revealed towards the end that kind of blew my mind. but yeah, it's really good. I'm surprised it didn't catch on. Oh, I should mention too, it has the voice work of Elijah Wood, Christopher Lloyd, John Cleese, Tim Curry, you know, amongst others that you'd probably recognize. But yeah, pretty solid overall. It's where did we see it? I can't remember where we saw it. I think it's Apple. On Paramount Plus or Peacock.
I think it's Apple.
It's worth a watch.
I thought it was on Apple.
Yeah. No, we didn't. We definitely didn't watch it on Apple because I don't have that anymore.
All right, fair enough.
Pretty sure we saw it on Paramount Plus, but definitely worth a watch if you have kids. It's a sweet little film.
I'm surprised neither of you mentioned a movie we talked about for the podcast when it was released, also directed by David Bruckner, and that's The Ritual. Do you remember that? A group of college friends reunite for a trip in the forest in northern Europe, but encounter a menacing...
I think I may have recommended that a couple weeks ago.
Ah, okay, fair enough.
I barely remember that film.
Oh, I remember being pretty solid.
I dug that one. That one was wild.
Yeah. All right, stay tuned for our next episode. Second Time Watchers is back. This time, Hermano has chosen to go back and have us take a look at Catherine Bigelow's classic vampire flick, Near Dark.
Yeah, it's the First Time Watchers podcast because we like to watch.
What I need to know is, have you seen the Megan trailer?
Yes.
Yes, you saw the Megan trailer.
Yeah.
Oh my God. You have got to, I mean, seriously, the people who cut that trailer knew exactly what the fuck they were doing.
Yeah.
Dude, that trailer is amazing. At first, my first reaction as the trailer starts, I'm like, nope, 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 nope. And then it keeps going. And I'm like, yes, 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 yeah. Yes.
Yeah, someone's a fan of Chucky.
it's like a mix of a Chucky movie and an orphan movie, and I'm all here for it.
Yeah, I can see that. Yep.
I'm here for it, man. I can't wait. I'm going to see this.
That's from James Wan, right?
Yeah. Yeah, I think he wrote, produced it. Yeah.
Yeah. He's in a mood, man, with that and Malignant.
All right. M3 Gan. That's what it is, M3 Gan. Allison Williams, I'm like, hey, I like her. I liked her from Get Out. I just watched Get Out. Story by James Wan, screenplay by somebody else. Wait, Aleka Cooper, I think, is also a writer of Malignant. I'm all right. I'm good. I'm here for it.
Yeah, I don't know if I'll go to the theater for it, but I'll definitely check it out.
But the real question is, has Wally seen the Megan trailer?
I have not.
Oh, you haven't seen the Megan trailer?
Wally doesn't watch trailers.
Oh, Wally, you got to go see the Megan trailer. It's M3 Gan. Megan. Go.
Should I watch it now?
Yes, you should watch it right now.
Let's look for M3 Gan trailer. No, none of this looks familiar. Let's take a watch. Megan official trailer.
Yes, Megan official trailer. You need to watch this. This is great.
Watch it. Great.
Some sort of puppet.
This is real time reaction right here, guys.
Well, this is like the kids do reaction videos.
I gotta see the black phone. I heard that.
Yes, black phone, good. Megan trailer, better. No reaction yet? Well, he doesn't like to give reactions. Especially in real time.
Are you worried that it's coming out in January, Tim?
No, of course not. You're just going to sit with
January
his arms.
January not the, the dumping ground that it used to be?
No, of course not.
Isn't that when Moonfall came out?
No, it came out in like March or something.
So March is the new dumping ground.
Yes, there it is.
Well, they must have laughed at the part she started dancing.
Yes.
All right, I'm in.
Yeah, you are.
I'm in for Tiny Terminator. The dog running is what made me go, what the? Because I was like, please let me, oh, I think I know where we're going with this. And I'm like, oh, I kind of wish you had them run, had her run kind of like Robert Patrick. Just dead stare. I wonder how they did the effect for that. If that's actually like all CGI, if it's like.
Oh, it's probably some.
Like an actual actress, like yeah. In just like a weird suit.
Yeah, probably that. I can't wait.